This is the case summary of the patient we're going to discuss today in the next hour or so. And this is a story of a 70-year-old male who presented us in October 2017 with high colored urine and itching of 2 months duration. And he was diagnosed as a periampullary lesion elsewhere by imaging. And he was advised Whipple's procedure. He chose to come to us. He's from a neighboring state. And then we evaluated the radiology, and we are fairly convinced that we are dealing with the case of a lesion, mass lesion at the periampullary area, possibly lower end of common bile duct, and we've subjected him for a Whipple's procedure. He was also a patient of a post-prostatectomy urethral stricture, for which he underwent urethral dilatation, and it was done in October of 2017. And on table, we could feel a 2 into 2 centimeter hard mass in head of the pancreas or possible lower end CBD. The CBD was dilated, the pancreas was not dilated, the fairly soft pancreas. The histopathology said that the CBD is an extensive denudation of mucosa with fibrosis. The head of the pancreas did not show any specific pathology. There were 6 regional lymph nodes with reactive changes. There's no evidence of malignancy. He had delayed gastric emptying, and then I routinely do a pancreatic gastrostomy. That's what I've been trained, been doing for many, many years. And then in due course of time, we did image him because of his delayed gastric emptying. There was a contained pancreatic gastrostomy leak, and then he recovered without any percutaneous or surgical intervention, and he was discharged home after a month of stay. In 2018, January, about 3 years from the 3 months from the time of Whipple's procedure, he had an excision of thrombospinal mass, and in a year after the main surgery, he had a laparoscopic tap for right inguinal hernia, and also had a cold cut incision of the stricture bulbar urethra. He started having vague upper abdominal discomfort and progressive loss of weight. We wondered whether there's anything new, any disease that had come up, and we evaluated, and we saw that the CT scan showed post Whipple's grossly dilated main pancreas. The MPD, which was anastomosed to the stomach, lumen of the stomach, was grossly dilated. But we wondered why he is losing weight, whether there's any nutritional. And we also realized that about 10 to 15% patients, Whipple patients, don't really regain weight and they have huge nutritional deficiency. We attribute to that. We tried doing a lot of nutritional correction, but to no avail. At some point of time, that is in May 2019, we decided that is the distended pancreatic duct was causing tremendous pain, and that needs to be treated. So we subjected to this patient to endoscopic ultrasound-guided pancreatic duct drainage. A drainage was attempted, but nothing more could be done. But then he started having recurrent abdominal pain again, and he continued to have loss of weight. Ultrasound, repeat ultrasound showed once again dilated pancreatic duct. And at this point of time, we spoke to a gastroenterologist, and we suggested that a stent can be put into the dilated pancreatic duct that would do a lot of good to the patient, because as the opening of the pancreatic gastrostomy could not be seen in endoscopy. With ultrasound guidance, with a 19-gauge needle, the duct was cannulated through the gastric wall, and fluid aspirated showed MLAs of 2,955 units per liter. And using a 6-French cystotome, a cut is made, and a 5-French, 7-centimeter straight stent was inserted in the pancreatic duct. But we also noticed that the pancreatic duct was not fully decompressed. We met at a subsequent investigation. We found that the stent was not exactly into the duct, it's somewhere into the parenchyma and the neighborhood. And then again, the gastroenterologist came back to us and wanted our opinion, and the plan was either to go again, put a metallic stent which may sit in the pancreatic duct, or consider re-surgery for the dilated pancreatic duct. In September 2019, he had a left vesicoureteral junction calculus, which was conservatively treated, and with that it became all right. And then we noticed that the LFTs are slightly increasing. One is he had a total bilirubin of 2.9 with a direct component of 2. AST, ALT were 250 and 148 respectively, and alkaline phosphatase was 352. We wondered whether he is developing some sort of liver disease. And when we imaged, we found there is a mild dilatation of intrahepatic biliary dilatation, and there was pneumobilia as well. So when we evaluated in toto and realized that he has one, an obstructed pancreatic gastrostomy and also an obstructed hepaticogizostomy. So in 2020, December, we went in. That is about 3 years from the time of Orrin Whipple's procedure. We went in and did a hepaticogizostomy, stricturoplasty, where there was a stone in the hepatic duct which we had to remove. And he also did a lateral pancreaticogizostomy. In addition, he also did a left inguinal herniarrhaphy, as he also had a hernia. He did well postoperatively, but for wound infection, which troubled him for a little while, and then it's all healed. Presently, he is sort of gained weight a little bit and is doing well. That is the story. And with that, I'll ask Gautam to take over. Gautam. There are some questions in the chat. I couldn't see, Gautam, if you can just address them.
What is the incidence of negative HPE following Whipple surgery? See, the usual benchmark used to be 10%, but nowadays with the EUS in our Army Meteorium and EUS guided FNB, FNA, I think less than the mark should be less than 2% in any center, even with all the availability of these facilities. The cause of dilated MPD, as we are about to discuss, it was in pancreatic or gastrostomy stenosis. So, having I'll just try to cut short whatever as Sarah's already told. I don't want to repeat, but just wanted to highlight certain things which probably is useful in following up patients following a pancreatic duodenectomy. So, this patient was operated for an suspected malignancy, had a post-operative complication with grade B pancreatic fistula as well as a delayed gastric emptying. And 15 months later, he presented with upper abdominal pain as well as weight loss of 5 kilograms over 2 months. There was also history of steatorrhea. During this period, he also had evidence of endocrine insufficiency, which was managed with insulin. However, when he presented at this 15-month juncture, there was nothing else clinically remarkable. And an imaging showed a feature suggestive of pancreatic gastrostomy stenosis. He was taken up for an endotherapy. In fact, twice endotherapy was attempted. In the first attempt, the PG site was never identified. So they planned for an endoscopic guided pancreatic duct cannulation, either stenting by rendezvous procedure or just a pancreatic or gastrostomy stent. But after the cannulation, guide wire was placed into the main pancreatic duct. But before the stent could be placed or the guide wire could be advanced, the guide wire had slipped out. So they had to abandon the procedure at that time. So they waited for some time. The patient again developed symptom. So during the second time, the EOS guided pancreaticogastrostomy was fashioned using a 5-French straight stent. However, patient continued to have symptoms. It was not like he was symptom free after the second procedure. In fact, after 4 months itself, he started developing symptoms. Imaging showed a slight dilatation of MPD, so which was taken as an incomplete drainage of the main pancreatic duct, and a suggestion of a surgery or an metallic stent placement was given. Patient was not very keen on surgery, so we thought we'll manage him conservatively. But then he started coming back with an increased frequency of pain, as well as a deranged LFTs. So we got an MRCP done. So this is the final image that was performed in him before we had taken him for a surgical intervention. So the MRCP confirmed the pancreaticogastrostomy stenosis with a diffuse dilatation of the main pancreatic duct. That is, starting from the tail to the site of anastomosis, the entire MPD was grossly dilated, including the side ducts. There are also multiple parenchymal calcifications were noted in an already atrophied pancreas. I will show you the images to elicit the same findings that have been noted here. The stent was found displaced within the stomach. So that explained why the patient didn't have a complete symptomatic relief following endotherapy. In addition to this, there was also a node made up of the dilated intrahepatic biliary radicals with evidence of cholangitic abscess. So these are the images. The first one is the axial cut from T2 weighted image. We can find the grossly so this is the grossly distended MPD. We can find there is also multiple filling voids, which are actually the calcifications which are noted in the parenchyma. We can find the entire MPD is distended from the tail of the pancreas to the pancreaticogastrostomy site. The second is the coronal image, which is showing the multiple T2 hyperintense lesions involving both lobes of the liver, as marked by the yellow arrow, suggestive of cholangitic abscess. And one on the right, extreme right, is the MRCP image, which shows a dilated IHDR with an abrupt narrowing at the level of anastomosis. So now we have a patient who has a pancreatic gastrostomy stenosis diagnosed for some time, was symptomatic for it, has undergone endotherapy twice. First time, it was in primary failure due to some technical reason. Second time, we could achieve stenting, but patient didn't have a good clinical outcome, possibly due to the displacement of the stent. And in addition to this, patient is now also having a hepaticojejunostomy stricture suspect. So, given these two compounding factors, we felt upfront surgery at this juncture would be more appropriate rather than giving an attempt again at endotherapy. So we explored the patient, and what we felt, instead of having to explore via the lesser sac to again take down the anastomosis or identify the PG site, we went through a transgastric route. We made an anterior gastrotomy, and via the anterior gastrotomy, the posterior gastric wall was palpated. The MPD was palpated and then localized using the needle, as we do in Frey's procedure. So once the duct was aspirated and localized, we made an posterior gastric rent, and through which the MPD was also opened. And then we fashioned the pancreaticogastrostomy using interrupted suture. We can also see the stent that is displaced and lying freely in the stomach. I just placed this image just to compare the size of the anastomosis that was created surgically vis-a-vis a 5-French stent that was actually used for the purpose of decompression of MPD. We can definitely find the surgical anastomosis far larger when compared to the stent size. when the hepaticojejunostomy site was explored, we found a large stone that was causing the obstruction. As such, there was no anastomosis, was quite wide. So we just did a strictoroplasty, and patient had an relatively uninfluenced postoperative, barring the wound site infection, which did grow carbapenem resistant Klebsiella pneumoniae, and he was treated with the appropriate antibiotics, initially as an IP basis, then followed as an OPD basis. So over the next 3 to 4 months, he is doing fine. His pain has resolved. His glycemic status is still the same, and he has gained 3 kgs of weight. So with this background, I would like to just go into the topic that we are planning to discuss today, that is the pancreaticoenteric stenosis following an pancreaticoduodenectomy. So we all know that the Achilles heel of an pancreaticoduodenectomy will be the pancreaticoenteric anastomosis, be it pancreaticojejunostomy or in pancreaticogastrostomy. And generally, we relate it to the immediate postoperative complications that we encounter in the form of either an intra-abdominal collection or a fistula or a secondary hemorrhage following a fistula or a secondary delayed gastric emptying following a retrogastric collection. So all these things are something which we commonly encounter and we prepared for. However, over long term, the same anastomosis can have a complication in the form of a stenosis. So the patients who have undergone a procedure for malignancy are unlikely to stay through such a long period of time to develop such a stenosis. Hence, it was seen predominantly in patients who have undergone an Whipple's procedure for a chronic pancreatitis or any other neoplasm of good prognosis, something like a cystic neoplasm of pancreas or such something like in our patient where a malignancy was suspected, but it turned out to be a benign etiology. So when the patient is going to have a longer survival, we are likely to encounter the pancreaticoenteric anastomosis stenosis. Starting from 1998, where Sato had started analyzing all the MRCP of images on of patients who are on follow-up after PD, there was a significant proportion of patients who had a radiologically detected stenosis. So this, based on many series, ranges from anywhere between 77 to 100%. However, the clinical relevance is way lower. These patients, though they might have a radiological stenosis, they hardly develop any symptoms which are clinically relevant. And in fact, even the largest study, which had a 257 patients followed up and a 27 patient who had undergone surgery, had only 11% risk of developing in pancreatic and enteric anastomosis stenosis. So the likely risk factors which can predispose for development of the stenosis are postoperative pancreatic fistula after the index surgery and chronic pancreatitis being the etiology for the first surgery. So though small diameter at the primary surgery is hypothesis to be also an additional factor, however, it has not been proved unequivocally. These patients present in three classically defined ways. One is asymptomatic. So these group of population are the ones who are radiologically detected. They don't have any evidence of pancreatitis. They don't have any evidence of exocrine insufficiency. So just on mere follow-up of patients on Whipple's, these are incidentally detected. The second and the more common group, which I would say will be the symptomatic patients who present with exocrine insufficiency. The endocrine insufficiency is unlikely due to the stenosis alone. It can be usually a manifestation of the atrophy of the pancreas following the stenosis, but since there is already Whipple's, patients are prone for exocrine insufficiency, and additional anastomotic stenosis can further aggravate the exocrine insufficiency. And the third group are the ones who start developing pancreatitis itself. So like in our patient, who didn't have calcification during the first surgery, but nearly 3 years later, multiple interventions and history suggestive of stenosis, he has now started developing calcifications, which is an hallmark of a chronic pancreatitis pathology. So as I said, not all patients who have exocrine insufficiency should be suspected to have an pancreatic enteric anastomosis stricture. It is more or less norm that these patients have. I will put forth a table of a systematic review which had analyzed this same problem. The likely etiology is removal of a functioning pancreatic parenchyma, the underlying disease as such, like chronic pancreatitis. We can also have the pancreatic enzymes not being utilized by the gastric juices. So there are so many etiologies that can lead to an exocrine insufficiency as such following Whipple's. So they can range as low as 33% to as high as even 100%. So this is not something uncommon, but whenever we have a patient who is having a significant pancreatic exocrine insufficiency, which is not responding to the conventional treatment, and if there is an imaging suggestive of a dilated MPD, I think we are having a possible corrective solution for such a patient. So these patients are likely to benefit from a drainage of the main pancreatic duct. So what are the investigations? The fecal elastase to identify the exocrine insufficiency, but more importantly, it is the radiology. So MRCP is the investigation of choice. So it helps us in identifying the stenosis by the narrowing of the pancreatic duct at the level of anastomosis and an upstream dilatation. It can also help us in identifying new onset or progression of chronic pancreatitis, like in heart patient. Rather than being static, MRCP can also be dynamic. There were 3 studies wherein they had used secretin to identify the stenosis and in fact actually grade the degree of stenosis. So this was one study where patients following a pancreaticojejunostomy reconstruction, they had done an MRCP, and following the static image, secretin was injected. We can find the panel A is the one which is the one before secretin was given. The panel B shows the slight dilatation of the MPD. There is some flow of some slightly hyper-intense nature of the jejunum that is closed by the pancreatic duct. In the panel C, we can find the jejunum being a little more hyper-intense, and the panel D, which represents at 14 minutes after secretin stimulation, the jejunum is better seen. So basically, it tries to indicate that the anastomosis is intact and the pancreas is secreting more fluid, and it's likely that the MRC patient is having a patent anastomosis with a good functioning pancreatic parenchyma. This is another group which had again done an secretin stimulation, MRCP, wherein they this is a pancreaticogastrostomy. This study had both the pancreaticogastrostomy as well as pancreaticojejunostomy as their index cases. So again, same philosophy, pre-secretin MRCP followed by secretin stimulation. They were trying to find out the amount of secretions that went into the stomach. So thereby trying to find indirectly the amount of secretion that was produced by the parenchyma pancreas. However, if you look at the 2 grading systems that have been proposed by both these studies, the first one is the one by the first group who told if the fluid was not observed, there is no secretion. If the fluid was limited facing the pancreaticogastrostomy, it's poor secretion. If the stomach was largely filled, it's moderate secretion. See, it is all very subjective grading process. Similarly, the second study also, poor secretion, moderate secretion, good secretion. Their grading was based on the 2 radiologists and their concurrence with the findings. As such, though MRCP can tell us the diagnosis of pancreatic enteric anastomosis stricture, but the severity still cannot be, is not foolproof, and the grading which has been proposed is highly subjective for us to follow. So it can be used as a means to confirm the diagnosis, but still I think the clinical picture will be dictating the treatment part and not the radiology as. So management, yes, initially we will start with pancreatic enzyme replacement therapy, try to manage it conservatively, but the patient is continuing to have persistent symptoms. The other options we have are the endotherapy as well as the surgical option. So coming to the endoscopic techniques that are used to manage this stenosis, we have the ERCP guided interventions as well as the EUS guided access and drainage procedures. So it appears straightforward, similar to our routine pancreatic duct cannulation in an otherwise normal patient. We see the anastomosis, then we try to pass in a guide wire, then place a stent, dilate it if we want. So it appears little straightforward when we try to use ERCP. So this is an fluoroscopic image where the ERCP has gone through the A limb of the GJ and has cannulated the PD, and the contrast is injected to show the MPD dilatation, and a stent was placed following this procedure. There is no actual guidelines to say how long these stents should be placed, how long they should be exchanged, and because probably of the rarity of the situation and probably the technique as such is little difficult. Why? I'll just explain. So this is a same patient. After 6 weeks of follow-up, we can find the anastomosis little more patent. It is little more obvious now. It appears little more dilated. So they can be assessed again. When to re-stent, how long to keep the stent are all highly variable. There are no guidelines which talk about these. But how? What is the challenge? See, if the anastomosis site is seen and it is cannulated, then there is nothing like. However, the endotherapy, that is a conventional ERCP, so successfully advancing the endoscope to reach up to the pancreaticojejunal anastomosis is challenging. And as I said, in our patient who had a pancreatic or gastrostomy, even a PG site could not be identified. That is why both the times they had to use an endoscopic ultrasound guidance to puncture the MPD. They couldn't go through the pancreatic or gastrostomy anastomosis as such. So whenever we have a difficulty in accessing the pancreatic or jejunostomy, we can use other means of endoscopies, the conventional upper GI endoscopy rather than the side view, which is used for ERCP. Because they are slightly longer, we can use an adult or pediatric colonoscope or an endoscope, which are likely to be more longer and have a better access to the anastomosis site. But using a forward viewing instrument again poses certain difficulties. They lack the elevators for us to cannulate it with an ease. The longer working channels, especially like an endoscope, means it's certain equipment instruments cannot be used through those scopes. And something like a pediatric scope, if it's used, we may not have a proper working channel for us to do all the procedures, therapeutic procedures. So there are a few landmarks in endoscopy which they use to identify this PJ site. Generally, as surgeons, we perform the HJ, hepaticojejunostomy, around 15 to 20 centimeters from the pancreaticojejunostomy. So, and hepaticojejunostomy is more or less well visualized in an endoscopy. So, probably 15 to 20 centimeters distal to the HJ when we come through the retro. Grade will be helping us in identifying. They are giving intravenous secretin during the process of endoscopy, and increase in pancreatic secretion may help us. But how effective it will be, I am a little skeptical, because pancreatic juice is also going to be transparent, and given the difficulties we already have in going up to that spot, how effective and secreting can help us, it's difficult to say. There have been studies which sprayed the mucosa with methylene blue. So, and fresh pancreatic enzyme inflow will disturb this blue hue and help us in identifying the site. So, given the difficulties of ERCP, EUS has now become the easier option for the endotherapist to do the drainage procedure. First, to help the ERCP cannulation, the initial attempts were using the EUS. The puncture was made. MPD was identified. So that is shown by the photo panel, which is on the extreme left, where we can find the endoscopy, side view scopy is being used. Using the endo ultrasound, the puncture is made, MPD is cannulated, the contrast is injected and it's confirmed, and following which the guide wire is inserted. The guide wire is inserted across the anastomosis, wherein the conventional ERCP comes and picks up the guide wire, and then a stent can be placed. So the other is an pancreatic anti-grade needle knife technique, or the PANC technique, where they identify the guide wire and they make a nick using the knife and place the stent anti-gradely, not the retrograde way as we do it in the EUS guidance. And finally, what was attempted in our patient twice, that is to just place the stent transmurally across the posterior gastric wall into the dilated pancreatic duct. So these are the various EUS guided measures that can be followed in tackling this pancreatic enteral anastomosis stenosis. This is a summary, this a review that was published in 2018 in Journal of Visceral Surgery, where we have the various modalities that were used, starting from ERCP to EUS Rondeway to PANC, to even some percutaneous. I'll also talk about some percutaneous techniques that have been used. We can find the last but one column on the right, stating what are the difficulties in doing these endoscopic measures. So in some patients, the anastomosis was not possible. In some patients, it was not seen. The progression could not be made by a conventional ERCP. So the same thing which happened in our patient. So the first attempt, the guide wire slipped out, then we couldn't cannulate. But the second attempt, the stent got displaced. So though technically a stent was placed in the second attempt, patient didn't have a long-term good outcome because the stent got displaced. So those are the problems which reduce the efficacy of an endotherapy in addressing this problem. So the primary failure and secondary failures, that's how they are classified into. Whenever there is anastomosis itself is not seen, be it, not visualized despite reaching that area or not able to reach that area, all these are considered as primary failure of endotherapy. The secondary failures are, as I discussed, due to the stent dislocation, the stent blockage. So what happens is, though the technique success rate can even reach up to 75%, the secondary failure rates and the other issues reduce the long-term outcome. So they come way below 75%. So pain relief is actually achieved only in half of these patients. Having known the procedures that are performed endoscopically as well as their outcomes, moving on to the surgical management, the most common surgical technique that has been used so far for addressing this problem is the revision of the pancreatic enteral anastomosis. So by means of revision, if a pancreatic jejunostomy is made, the pancreatic jejunostomy is dissected out, it is dismembered, and the pancreatic duct is opened up. It can be opened up just for 1 or 2 centimeters, or it can be opened up along the entire length, something similar to our modified Pusto. And then the jejunum is again anastomosis. So we can have an extended drainage of MPD using the same jejunal limb or a different limb, something like a roux. And to be frank, in contrast to the index surgery of Whipple's, the revision surgeries generally have a better immediate postoperative outcome, probably because of the harder pancreas and the dilated pancreatic duct we might be dealing with. this is a representative image where the photo on the left side is showing the stents which are placed into the MPD. So we can find one stent which is already in the MPD. We can also find an infant feeding tube which is inserted. It was a bifid pancreatic duct. So the authors had actually cannulated both the two pancreatic ducts. The one on the left is the jejunal opening. So the entire anastomosis was revised. The same authors in few patients, in view of a multiple ductal calcifications, opened the pancreas along the entire MPD anteriorly and did something similar to a modified Eustace procedure. So these are the conventional surgical options that we have. The first one is the classical revision. The second one is we can do a revision and add on a lateral pancreaticojejunostomy. And the third one is the posterior pancreaticogastrostomy. So posterior pancreaticogastrostomy is where the authors, there are I think 3 or 4 case reports and one good study. The study also had only 3 patients, but they had described not dismantling the GJ, not going to the PJ site, but going through the lesser sac, just proximal to the GJ, doing a dissection, entering the lesser sac and fashioning and pancreaticogastrostomy where the stomach is directly opposing the dilated MPD. So that is the conventional posterior pancreaticogastrostomy that has been described so far. So why do we need the posterior pancreaticogastrostomy and why did we try to modify? Because as we know, any patient following resurgery, especially Whipple's, is going to be challenging. If a patient is going to have a postoperative complication such as a pancreatic fistula and the entire area is going to be densely adherent, and there have been, if I'm not wrong, there are 2 patients who are explored in one study for a revision of pancreatic enteric anastomosis, but the authors had to abandon the procedure in view of dense adhesions. And also, if we think in depth, doing the anastomosis in a hard dilated pancreas is something likely to have a better outcome. So if at all the morbidity occurs following a revision procedure, it is likely due to the dissection that we carry out in that space. Be it bleeding, be it longer post-operative or intraoperative time. So all those things are likely to be a result of the dense adhesions we are likely to encounter in this area. So in that way, and pancreatic or gastrostomy reconstruction stays away from this anastomosis. And in future, if suppose we want to examine the adequacy of drainage and the anastomosis, revised anastomosis, we can do it by means of an endoscopy. So this is what I described, wherein we, the Kitani group, as early as 2009, had published 3 patients who had undergone a posterior pancreatic or gastrostomy. As I said, the access was through the lesser sac. They didn't go transgastric. We felt because the duct was grossly distended and in view of the postoperative complications that he had following the first surgery, if we can get via transgastric route, it might make a job slightly easier. So these are the results shown by the Kitani group. As we can see, the blood loss was as high as 500 ml in one of these patients. This is despite them not dismantling the primary anastomosis and just going through the lesser sac to do a pancreatic or gastrostomy. They did show good long-term outcome. So even after, I think, 18 months of follow-up, they didn't show good symptomatic relief. The overall long-term success rate of surgical interventions for this problem is ranging from 26 to 100%. So this, again, the summary of studies, surgical studies, wherein surgery was performed for a pancreatic or enteral anastomosis stricture. This is the largest one, which is Morgan, which had 27 patients and we can see they did have morbidity 6, and none of them required resurgery. There was no mortality as such, but they did show that the long term success rate was not as good.
Happy cake da.
In fact, there have been questions raised: is it worth, given the poor long term success proposed by few studies, is it worth enough to go and surgically revise this anastomosis? But some of the pancreatic or gastrostomy studies have shown a better outcome. So it's a call, I think, subjective call. Just an case report which I came across where they did a percutaneous management of this pancreatic enteral anastomosis structure. So the IHB, the liver was punctured, and through the hepaticogegenostomy, a guide wire was advanced, which was used to advance a catheter. The pancreatic enteral anastomosis was catheterized, and then the conventional dilatation was done. But it's just a case report. It's difficult probably to replicate it. This is a basic algorithm, which I did take it from one of the articles published in Journals of Gastrointestinal Surgery, which I think is fair enough for us to follow. So any patient who is suspected to have a pancreatic or enteral anastomosis stricture, who presents to us with an abdominal pain suggestive of recurrent acute pancreatitis, I think we should give them an intervention as the first choice rather than placing them on medical management. Given the less invasive endoscopic measures, we can attempt an initial endoscopic management of these individuals. In case of any failure, we can plan for a surgical management. If the problem is only with an impaired pancreatic function, rather than planning for an intervention, because both endoscopy and surgery are not 100% successful on the long term, we can try to maintain them on a pancreatic enzyme replacement therapy. A third line, I don't think we'll be having too many cases, but that is the one proposed by this algorithm. So coming to this, so at the end, there are indications or interventions. So primarily pain should be the intervention. If there is a pain without a significant MPD dilatation, then there's a marginal indication for planning for intervention. EUS guided techniques, yes, they are advancing with the more adjuncts that they have used, and the armamentarium widening day by day in an EUS era. It is likely that they are likely to have an improved success rate. However, surgery does have a good technical success rate for especially patients who have failed endotherapy.
Wonderful discussion, Gautam. I'll ask Ilango if he's there to come in to come with his comments. Ilango?
Sir? Sorry, I joined Facebook for a little while before I came here. Nice case discussion, sir. I think the issue of pancreatic enteric anastomosis stricture, we are missing because we are more focused on the malignancy. And these patients, once we do a Whipple for a malignancy, they switch over their loyalty to a medical oncologist. So after that, we never, and most of the pains, aches and pains are all attributed to some other thing rather than the actual problem of a stricture. And another possibility is that we may not be seeing them in the long run. Only when we do surgeries for benign Whipple, and this is a, so my questions to you was the pancreatic gastrostomy a Dunking procedure or a ductal mucosa anastomosis?
It's a Dunking procedure, Ilango. I mean, I've never attempted doing a duct mucosa ever in the pancreatic gastrostomy, ever. Gastrostomy. Just Dunking. And actually, I've noticed that in one of the series in All Indian Institute, we had trouble with these anastomosis. So we started inserting a stent. Once a stent is in situ with the 3-4 centimeters jutting into the stomach, we'll make sure that there's no bite taken on the stent. And usually after a couple of days, the stent comes out and, you know, goes in the GI tract. And many a times patients come up scared seeing some little plastic thing coming out. We do make a mention to them. So it's always a Dunking procedure.
So I have nothing else to add, sir. I just see, I learned the initial MS training days where we had Professor Anandakumar operating in Trivandrum. They used to do the dunking procedure in the jejunum, a PJ. And then I have seen some senior surgeons in Madurai also do the same. That looked very nice. But during MCH training, we were taught only one technique, the Buchler's technique for PJ. That was the only thing that was taught in Madras Medical College. And we all became very familiar doing that. Initial years were like that. I think 2011-12, we had the Bloomgard technique of anastomosis. So when I was in Kalyani, I did a couple of cases on that. Turned out very good, especially when you take the serosal bites. But I think the US training changed my view towards the ductal mucous anastomosis completely. We did some Whipples there, and I did most of them with the ductal mucous anastomosis. With the magnifying loop, a ductal mucous or PJ becomes very, very easy. But again, it is not a safe, foolproof method for this structure. So I think those anastomosis also strictures, it's only that we are not picking it up. It's interesting you picked up, you solved the problem, but I think I would have done the same thing. I would have just gone, see, if you see the pancreas, it lies just behind the stomach. And in a post-operative stomach, yeah, whatever way you go, trying to avoid the stomach will cause more bleeding. What you did was direct, straight, solve the problem straight away. But the stone was a surprise. Did you expect that?
Yeah, actually, I was wondering. See, this patient's follow-up was very strange. One is that he was losing weight and is having abdominal pain. And after a while, it started developing a recurrent cholangitis-like picture. So we weren't very sure whether he's developing some sort of a cirrhotic liver dysfunction, or because we generally, we don't expect pancreatic hepaticojejunostomy after a Whipple's procedure to stricture. They may have a leak or two that in the immediate post-op, but still, because usually it'll be very dilated bile ducts. Anastomosis is quite roomy, and it doesn't happen. Of course, in this patient, the pancreatic duct is very nice, very, very nominal in size. So that wasn't expected, actually. When we did an MRCP, and we saw that the liver function pattern is of an obstructive nature, and it is an MRCP, showed a dilated IHBR, then we realized that there is some narrowing there also, which need to be, and that explained his fever, chills, and itching, and so on.
How? Pari has a question, sir.
Yeah.
Pari, unmute yourself.
Hello, sir. How are you?
Nice, Pari, seeing you in a long, long time.
Yeah, same here. The fantastic case, sir. Very interesting. And absolutely, I'm seeing this being discussed for the first time. So very well done. So few things what I had thought. So my observation has been that long-term patients who have undergone either PJ or PG, dunking without a ductal mucosa, I would say majority of them, almost 80% of them, in long term, come back with atrophic pancreas with dilated duct. And so it's been a very, very common observation. And all of them have been asymptomatic, never had this type of pain. So I was seeing this patient with a dilated duct and especially completely atrophic gland, I would be searching for some other cause of pain. And in this case, I would have thought that probably the cause of pain was more likely because of the stone in the bile duct. Because it's not common to see a biliary stricture there after a PJ, just as you mentioned. So in this case, I have a feeling that the cause of pain was more likely the stone in the HJ anastomosis rather than the PG stricture. So I would have tended to percutaneously dilate the duct, the HJ, and probably if the pain might have settled, I don't know. But definitely there was a place for dealing with the HA because there was cholangitis and jaundice. So maybe, and the other thing was these patients who develop a HJ anastomosis, anastomotic stricture, are more likely to have severe steatorrhea because you don't get the alkaline juice of the alkaline juice, which was going to make the pancreatic enzymes active. So maybe the HJ anastomotic stricture dilatation might have worked a little bit on the exocrine insufficiency also. And maybe that could have actually made him gain weight and also, you know, the other aspect of it. So maybe I would have, one, instead of straight going into surgery, might have tried with a percutaneous HJ stricture dilatation. I'm not sure.
That's a point well taken, Hari. But there are two things to it. One is when he had presented with pain in the initial stages, all that we had was a dilated pancreatic duct and there's no dilated HPR or any altered liver function in the beginning. And that's when the pain and dilated pancreatic duct, obviously, you know, we first thing we wondered, of course, is a functioning pancreas. So, you know, that the pressure in the duct increase and then this pain. So first intervention was done. But the second time when he had pain again after the pancreatic ductal decompression, this is the time he had IHBRD. Actually, frankly, an ultrasound, it was not very significant. The liver function test is only about 2.1, 2.2 is a bilirubin. Only MRCP looked a scary picture. But otherwise, to really focus completely on the biliary tree and not on the pancreatic duct, you know, it is not usually the... It was pointing more towards the pancreatic duct. The bile ductal dilatation came late. If it was one of the early presenting things, that could be a thing which you could have considered.
No, I'm wondering, suppose now that you have got a MRCP and showed a significant stone, which means that the stricture was significant, if you've done a percutaneous intervention, like you balloon dilated the HA stricture, and if the patient became asymptomatic, would you have still gone ahead and did a PG revision? That was my question.
Well, we won't have. But again, if you see the size of the stone at the HJ, is significant. But percutaneous drainage, but we could have dealt with that. I don't know. Because if you have to really bring that stone out with a dormier or something, we'd make a big hole in the abdominal wall.
No, true. Because the MRCP, I was just thinking that's going to be like a sludge. But it did look like a proper stone in the intraoperative pictures. But otherwise, initially, I would have thought that just a big sludge, and then probably I would have attempted a hepaticogenostomy stricture dilatation. Anyway, now that we know that it was a big, huge stone, probably percutaneous stricture dilatation might not have worked. But probably, retrospect, we are more clear, but this is what I would have initially tried.
Now, I had seen one... a very senior geriatric surgeon who had undergone BPH procedure, one of the senior surgeons in Chennai, was admitted with me for a while, and he also had a hugely dilated post-BPH PG pancreatic duct. But I think he had some vague symptoms. Pain is only a part of it. You know, I was suggesting a procedure in him, but then he refused later on. Gautam, I have a couple of questions to you. Gautam?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Now, the first point is that one is to, when you have, as Ilang was commenting on dunking versus ductal mucosa, is there any difference of the stricture rate? Even in the pancreatic gastrostomy group, whether they found that the dunking, the compared dunking versus ductal mucosa?
Sir, to be frank, all the surgical series are in single institute series. So they have done only a single type of anastomosis to actually follow up these patients. Difficult to compare. And whatever they have published and when it has been compiled, there is no difference between PG and PJ.
Right.
But dunking and ductal mucosa, I think it's very difficult because it depends from institute to institute and the studies only have their own institute patients.
Yeah. Question two is it that a patient who had a stormy post-operative period in terms of a leak-contained leak are likely to develop these strictures rather than the ones who had a clean sailing?
Yes, sir. That is a known risk factor. any patient who has a postoperative pancreatic fistula are more likely to develop the pancreatic enteral anastomosis stricture.
Why that?
Because of the peri anastomosic inflammation, we are likely to have the inflammation which is going to be transmural as well. Since the anastomosis is probably leaking at one point, inflammation is not going to be only on the serosal side, only on the external side. It's going to be a transmural inflammation that we are likely to encounter.
Can I add a point?
Yeah.
We are not getting routine imaging after Whipple for everyone. And so we may never know the true status of our anastomotic technique. Unless we do it regularly and then follow up, we will never know. We just go by the clinical means of getting better. And if the patient loses weight or gets steatorrhea, we'll blame it on something else medical. We'll never think of a pancreatic enteric stricture unless we do routine imaging. Like Pari says, if you just see these PET images, we might get more a better clinical picture of
That's true, sir. That is the idea. The problem is, radiologically, there is a high proportion of patients who are going to have this stenosis. But thing is, they are not going to be clinically relevant. So whether at all imaging for identifying this stenosis is significant, that is questionable. Because we are not going to intervene.
So far, we were bothered about the malignancy more than the results of the procedure. But if we end up doing more benign cases like cystic neoplasms, early tumors, mucosal tumors, which we can diagnose much earlier now, those patients will live longer, and then we'll be forced to look at quality of life. That's what I feel. Patta sir, what is your comment on that?
Yeah, I agree. Gautam, the thing of bilirubin stricture with pancreatic gastrostomic strictures, are there any other case reports or any incidents? And what do you think could be the cause for this HJ stenosis?
Sir, there only one thing which I could note was there was a case report where two cases in one of the series where the jejunal limb which was used to fashion the PJ and the HJ had been gone in for a kinking at the level of transverse mesocolon.
Mm-hmm.
That can explain the dysfunction of the HJ as well as PJ, but it doesn't explain the stenosis at both the sides.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know whether they can be related to each other.
Sir, can I add a point here?
Yeah.
Ilango had mentioned that we don't routinely do a CT, but like to differ from with him on that account, because once a year the patients on long-term follow-up, at least once a year we tend to do a CT scan, not primarily looking at the PJ anastomotic stricture or anything, looking for metastasis. So what we found was several interesting things that we found way back back in SGPJ itself. We had one of my colleagues do this, auditing the post Whipple's CT scans in long-term followers. Things we found were, one, invariably patients with non-ductal mucosa anastomosis patients invariably had an atrophic pancreas and a dilated duct, this one. Few other things which we noticed were, there is a fairly increased incidence of portal vein thrombosis in these patients, which we don't know why. And then there is another interesting thing which we noticed were a rind of tissue, thick fibrous tissue forming around the SMV and the splenic artery. And then there is a high proportion of patients who develop CLD-like findings on CT scan. And so that is how we knew that finding of atrophic pancreas with the dilated duct was one of the commonest things that we found on CT scans done on long-term follow-ups in these patients. And I don't remember anyone being actually symptomatic for that. These were all the findings which we found in a routine follow-up of our PD patients. And in fact, one of my colleagues, Dr. Ajay Sharma, was writing a paper on that also. I don't know whether it got published. We left the institute before that. But this was one of the fairly common findings that we had noticed.
Do these patients have pancreatic insufficiency? Do they require
yes,
long-term
some of them.
Enzyme replacement?
Very few, very few. Very few of them have pancreatic insufficiency. I would say negligible amount, negligible proportion, despite having a dilated duct, have pancreatic insufficiency. Very few have occasional pancreatic insufficiencies when they have sweets or very high carbohydrate, high fat diet or something like that, but that's also not common. But finding this dilated duct with atrophic pancreas is very, very common finding.
So, Pari, will you use pancreatic enzyme replacement for
when there is weight loss and there is no other reason to explain that, when we don't find secondaries, but when the patient has weight loss, we use pancreatic enzyme supplements. That is exacerbated by biliary obstruction. So we do use occasionally, we do use pancreatic supplements in these patients when there is significant weight loss.
Gautam, Pratiksha has got a couple of questions in the chat box. If you can just go through and address some of them.
We routinely do investigations to differentiate between type 2 diabetes mellitus and type 3C, unlikely, because the management is by and large going to be the same. We are not going to identify brittle and try to change it a lot. Pre-Whipple LFT, I really don't have an idea of it, but the CBD was dilated by imaging, so likely to be deranged. Parenchymal calcifications were absent. And regarding autoimmune pancreatitis, there is no evidence on histology. So we have the entire specimen. So there is no point in suspecting autoimmune. Should surgery or EUS guided therapy rather than PERT in patients with pain? Yes, I think that is important. Probably in pain, which is going to be more severe and should be a better indicator for intervention rather than medical management. Can serum amylase and lipase be done in pain episodes? Yes, but how reliable they will be, it's difficult to say, given the parenchymal atrophy that these patients have. How stone has formed with an intact HJ? There are so many possibilities. It's all hypothesis. Difficult to say when you have an anastomosis which is greater than 1 to 1.5 centimeters with still a stone there. You can have an stitch reaction, which was an IDUS to stone initially, which formed the nucleus over which the stone started developing more. Any patient who had an obstructed system who undergoes drainage have the biliary system and it's drained immediately or have more lithogenic than a normal bite. So probably it was some NIDUS which had developed the immediate postoperative period, and over a period of time it has. It is not something which had occurred just in the last 2 months or 3 months.
Gautam?
Yes, sir.
I would just love if you can go back and look at the CT images to see if these findings were there. Many patients develop portal vein, SMV portal vein stenosis, thick rind of tissue around the SMV portal vein, and then the findings of CLD like changes on the liver and all. I mean, just curious.
We'll definitely do.
Okay, one last question, if there's no any comments from anyone. See, the endoscopic intervention seems to be helping only temporarily. They are technically difficult and isn't seating a stent in that area. So given a chance, would you still attempt endoscopy or would you go for surgery straight? I want all three of you to comment, Gautam, Longo and Pari.
I told you I'm not very convinced about the
need for surgery.
So probably I would, this is the first time I'm hearing about this technique. So now that I know, I probably pester my GA colleague to put in a stent and see whether that helps. And obviously it's not a cakewalk. Sir, you did it, but you know, it's going to be a nightmare trying to do this surgery. I would rather stay away from trying this, attempting that.
Hello?
I would do the same thing what you have done, sir.
Because,
same approach. Yeah.
For because when what we have seen is percutaneous It's actually, once you put in a needle, it's completely decompresses. After that, you don't know where to go. Stents don't stay in. You technically, even for an endoscope, it's you know, not so. And versus a pancreatic jejunostomy stricture, where endoscope is just next to impossible. So, I mean, I'm just wondering, maybe it should be. Yeah, Gautam.
Sir, I agree, sir. The technical difficulties of endoscopy still remain, especially after PG. When we perform, the scope doesn't stay there. It keeps coming back into the larger body of the stomach. It doesn't stay there. So it is difficult. But I would still give an attempt of endoscopic management before proceeding with surgery.
So once, what I feel is, if there is actually so much of secretions in the pancreas under pressure, if you make a path for it to come, whether you place a stent or not, it will stay. So the fluid and the pressure will find a way to go into a lumen. And so basically, I'm still not very convinced that whether it's actually required. But suppose if it is required, then probably surgical is the, you know, the thing for the one-stop solution. But I would rather attempt endoscopic means first. And if it fails, I am more convinced to go for this surgery, because it's not going to be an easy surgery. So your pictures were looking as if it was easy, but I'm sure.
Bari, you being such a big time surgeon, I wonder, how was it difficult? I think opening the anterior wall stomach is a difficult,
sir.
Easiest thing to do, because even when you have a pancreatic gastrostomy, post pancreatic gastrostomy bleed into the stomach, the simplest thing to do is open the stomach and
absolutely. But finding the duct. So that's going to be the challenge.
When the duct is distended, I'll tell you, it's only the duct you'll feel. You don't feel the pancreas inside the stomach. I mean, it's such a, if you see the MRCP, it's such a, I mean, it's bigger than the thumb, actually. That shouldn't be a problem. And this, you know, a needle can always be put in. It's a dilated duct. When you see LPGS left, right, center, it shouldn't be a difficult one. It's
okay,
only
so
the anterior wall of the stomach.
Okay, so that's because you had a stump of stomach projecting into the stump of the pancreas, projecting in the stomach.
No.
It'll never be there.
It'll yeah, be because there. It necroses off. It falls off. Yeah.
Even 2 centimeters you dunk into the stomach, after a while you put an endoscope, it'll not be there.
It's not there. Yeah, true.
The gastric mucosa will take over.
So how exactly did you localize that? This is the point of previous PJ, sir. So how did you localize that?
Palpate. But palpation itself, we can see a big cigar-like feel just in the posterior wall. Put a needle and you can see the thing coming out. What? Nothing else is there. It's aorta vertically, pancreas horizontally. So, you know, you can only get into the pancreas.
Okay.
So any other comment, any last comment, Ilango, before we close this session?
Oh, sir, it's a very nice case. Enjoyed it.
Yeah. Gautam?
Yes.
If you're done, thank you all so much for being with us this evening, and we'll allow to come back with more cases on Tuesdays. Thanks. Nice to see you, Pari. Thanks, Ilango.
Same here, sir.
Thanks, thank everyone.
You. Bye, Ilango.
Bye-bye.
Bye, Gautam. See you all.
Thanks, Gautam, for this effort.